Today we're going to talk about smoke. Now I don't mean the smoke that you hold in your mouth, I mean the smoke that you use on your bees. Now your smoke is going to be probably the second most important thing you're actually going to need when you're a beekeeper. The first important thing you need is some sort of bee veil, some sort of suit, some sort of headgear at least, at the very minimum. You know, if you've got some crazy bees that you've caught out of your neighbour's swarm patch, you're probably going to want a proper bee suit, but we're not talking about bee suits. We're talking about the next thing you're going to need, which is your smoker. Now, if you're wondering why you need smoke on your bees, it's because our ancestors figured out if there's smoke, the bees go in and they gorge themselves on the honey because they think their nest's in threat. It also gets rid of the guard bees. They all get all distracted and run around and go, "Whoa, heck, heck, we're under attack from a fire." So you're aiming to pretend that there's a fire coming through the atmosphere or through the forest or, you know, in their natural environment. So they would be gorging on the honey, ready to escape their tree habitat and go somewhere else so they could survive. But of course, you don't want to scare them so much as that they bugger off. So there's a certain balance with your smoking of your beehive. Back before the bees were put in boxes and the beekeepers used to have to go out and forage for them in the wild, sometimes they'd be hanging under a cliff or sometimes they'd be in an old tree. And they'd take an old branch and they'd light that up and they'd smoke underneath the hive so as that the bees would get distracted and then they could go and take the honeycomb from the outside that they wanted so they could harvest some honey. Luckily for you, you don't have to go wandering through the forest or climbing up a mountainside. You can have your bees in a box. And what's more, our ancestors in beekeeping got all excited and made something called a smoker, which is rather cool. Oh, sorry about my bee cage. One other little footnote I'd like to say, if you're going to be moving around and you're going to take your smoker from one site to another, get yourself a tin pot, at least so it's flame proof. Don't put anything flammable in your tin pot when you've got your smoker in there, even if you think you put it out, because things can go awry. There's been a few tales about smokers catching things on fire. I was talking to a lad down the southeast who was coming home from working the bees, and his mum come running out of the house, waving her hands, going, "Whoa, whoa, stop, 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 stop." And he drove on past and he looked in his rear vision mirror and the back of his ute was on fire. So not ideal, not necessarily a good idea. So a metal tin pot. You can buy specifically specially made smoker tins. I've got one of them somewhere, which I didn't bring out. But you can just go to the hardware store and just get yourself a tin toolbox. That'll suffice. Just all depends how excited you want to get. Very simple thing a smoker is. It's actually got a little bellows at the bottom. And if you get bored of being a beekeeper, you could probably turn this into your own little forge. So you could, you know, heat up some coal and make some metal instruments, but maybe not either. But anyway, there you go. There you can see there's a bit of dust smoke. Tell you what, that's another thing. If it's a real emergency and you can't be bothered lighting your smoke and you just want a little tiny puff, you've got one little bee box. You'll have some residue in there that you can tear them up with a bit, but not ideal, probably not recommended. As you can imagine, over the last few hundred years, there's been several different things used to put in the smoker. I mean, heck, I think we started off with grass. Now, if you're going to use grass, you want to get a pile of wad of decent grass on fire and then put some not completely dry grass at the top, because the thing you want is you don't want hot smoke, because that really freaks the gals out. You want it to be a cool smoke that'll just sort of calm everybody down and calm you down. I mean, back in the day when tobacco wasn't blooming $10,000 an ounce, you could put that in there. So I'm not really sure whether nicotine on your honey is a good option, but hell, who knows? I suppose smoking a smoker makes sense. Anyway, in the modern day and age, we got some old Hessian sacks that I've got. This is about the only bit left I could find to show you. I got plenty out at the farm, but so old Hessian is better than new Hessian, I find. You can go around to the coffee roasters. It's about the only place left, I think, that import products in Hessian bags. There might be a few other places. Me, I've got Hessian laying around from when I was a kid growing up in the almond industry. We used to put our almonds in Hessian sacks and they used to get carted off to the processing plants. Golly gosh, when I think about where we are now as an almond industry and where we were when I was a kid, it kind of does my head in. But anyway, and what's more, if you happen to know in Australia, if you happen to know a grain grower, he's probably going to have some Hessian sacks in the back of his shed if he hasn't burnt them all. And they seem to work beautiful. Some of the old hemp sacks, they were the best. They'll smoulder away nicely. If you're going to use Hessian, it's a good idea to have it in a strip. And then you want to roll it up one way and roll it up from the other way. because it all depends how big your smoker is. And you want to kind of have the two circles meeting like that, so then it will draw up through the middle, and then you just light that up and put it in your smoker after it's got burning a bit, and it'll smoulder away nicely, and it's quite effective. Doesn't block up your smoker as much as other things. But having said that, if you're on your way to your bee yard and you've forgotten your hessian, and you think, oh my goodness, I've already traveled a half an hour away from home, you go, oh, now what am I going to do? Don't panic, don't turn around, don't drive back home to get your hessian. There's another solution. Just look for a pine tree. They're everywhere, surely you can find a pine tree on your way to the bee yard. Hell, I've got pine trees in the bee yard. So just, and you just go there, pick yourself up some pine needles, which I happen to have in my bag. So these are your pine needles, obviously. You can use other leaves, of course. In a real emergency, we've even used cow shit, which is rather interesting. I don't recommend that because you smell horrid when you get home. Luckily, me and the wife were both working the yard together with the shit, so we both smelt like crap, so wasn't so bad. But when we got back and we realised how bad we smelt, we had to both go and have a shower before we did any cuddling. Now, for lighting pine needles, it's a little bit more complicated than lighting up your jolly bag. What I like to do is you put your fresh pine needles a little bit in the bottom. I normally carry myself a can of like RP7, but you can use some metho if you really want, but I found metho sort of runs out the bottom and you set fire to the trailer or the back of your ute, which is unacceptable. Not ideal if your back of the ute's on fire in the middle of your farmer's grain paddock. Probably not recommended. So anyway, I've transitioned and I've got myself some RP7 or some Aerostart or whatever you can find. This happened to be laying in the back of my ute when I thought, well, I'll give that a crack. So I just give it a bit of a squirt. And then you get your lighter. And she, off she goes, whoosh. Try not to leave that right next to each other. The thing to remember, of course, if you're going to use something, some sort of accelerant like this, you want to make sure you've got it all burnt before you start using it as the smoke. You don't want that smelly muck in the girl's nostrils because they won't enjoy it at all. Now, you got a bit of fire going here, so you give her a bit of a puff, you get a bit of a chimney happening, get yourself a little bit more. Now, don't get carried away or you'll put yourself out. Having said that, I'll probably put myself out anyway now you're watching. Looks like I've got down there a little bit. Right, put a bit more on the top. Until it gets caught, you got to give it a little bit of air. Now, if you're really clever and you're on a reasonably windy day, see that little hole at the bottom that's feeding from the bellow? If you can face that where the wind's blowing, it'll just prime itself while you get your rest of yourself organised. But if it's not windy, well, you know, you got to sit here and just blow a bit. Now, the downside to pine needles is that it sort of gums up the front of your jolly smoker a little bit more than rags and bags and grass and whatever else. But hell, just remember to carry yourself a pair of scissors along with you, and you just give that a little bit of a scrape out, and you're not going to be in trouble anyway. So all these resources that you take along with you. Now, when you get to this point, you want to make sure that you're not actually got hot smoke coming out of there, because you don't want to be, like I said, you don't want this to be that hot. I mean, obviously it's going to be a little bit warm, but you know what? Cool smoke is what you're looking for. I mean, ultimately, you don't want blooming flames flying out the front of your smoker. That's not ideal, all right? So that's a crazy idea. Not only is it a safety hazard because you might set fire to things. It's interesting when you do this smoking gig in the dark, you can see a few bits of, you know, sparks and stuff coming out here. So you've got to stack your smoker correctly so you don't get any sparks coming out, because heaven forbid, if you happen to light up the grass fields that you're working in, it's not ideal. I mean, obviously you have your fire extinguisher with you, but sometimes it doesn't always happen quite to plan. So you just better not to light the paddock than to put the paddock out. That's my plan anyway. But of course, if you're like we are just at the minute and we're in the wife's backyard, we're on a green lawn, it doesn't matter. You could probably bloomin' have a raging inferno. As a matter of fact, you could probably just carry a stick of your own and smoke them with that. And what the hell, throw that on the ground and light up the pine bark. I mean, what the heck? But of course, if you don't want to get divorced, perhaps don't light up your wife's pine bark, because it might not be ideal. You might be the first and last experience you have at beekeeping. Now, of course, now you've gone to all this trouble of getting the smoker lit and getting the smoker to smoke. When you get to your beehive, you don't need to get carried away, okay? Just don't get psycho and drown them in smoke, because just remember, all the time that they're gorging on your honey is the less honey you're going to get to eat. So just take it out a little bit. You want to give a few puffs in the opening of your beehive, just so as the guard bees don't know what the hell's going on, and they'll all scurry off and go, oh, oh, help, 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 there's trouble. And then you, when you lift your lid up, just lift, crack the lid open, and just go one, two, three, under the lid, put the lid back down, wait about 10 seconds. By that stage, the bees have all sort of run off the top of the box reasonably well, and they'll go back down out of the way. Then you can take the lid off, take your hive mat off, and you can start working inside your hive without too many troubles. Generally speaking, the bees that'll give you trouble are the ones that have come back from foraging and they haven't had any smoke and they're not sure what's going on. And they consider you to be an intruder, perhaps a big polar bear there in your white suit. And then they'll give you a bit of a hurry up if you're not careful. So you want to just leave your smoker somewhere nearby so there's enough field bees come back and you just give them a little hoof as well. But the nurse bees that are inside your hive, well, they don't mind anyway because they're not too fussed. They're like children. They just go, well, we're not really sure what the hell's going on. Now, of course, if you're not a migratory beekeeper, you're just going to be able to just put this smoker in, well, probably not in your kitchen while it's still smouldering because that doesn't make for happy relationships. Perhaps put it back in the shed somewhere it's not going to fit fire to anything. But if you're going to have to travel home, say you've got a bee yard a little bit further from home, I normally just have a stick. You can get really excited and get a proper carved thing for your opening, but this seems to work just as good. And I just plug up the front of the hole, and then you make sure you put it in your fireproof box. Now, please don't put your cigarette lighter or your can of accelerant or anything else in here that's real flammable. Don't put the hessian in with your smoker. That's not ideal, because you never know, you might set fire to something that you don't want to happen. You just pop it in here, pop it in your tin box, so it can't set fire to too much. Put its lid on. Hey presto, safe as houses. If you put your flamethrower in the box, you're going to be in trouble. Anyway, that's how you light your smoker. Mind you, after you've done it 20 or 30 or 1,000 times, you'll come up with your own system that works. I have heard it said that you can use cardboard. I haven't had a lot of success with that, but hell, if you've got a photo of your smoker full of cardboard working nicely in your backyard, perhaps put it up on the forum. If you're enjoying these episodes and learning about how to become a young beekeeper or an old beekeeper getting into beekeeping, and you'd like to share the love, why don't you consider going down to the Patreon support page just down here somewhere? Heck, if you get so inclined and give us 10 bucks, you can join the club. You'll get your questions answered. You can send us emails and we'll do a Q&A on them. There is also a live Q&A's that we're setting up. We're still working out, we're ironing out the details, but anyway. And of course, a shout out to all you guys that are already supporting us. Thank you very much. You make this show possible. And hell, I don't know how else to say it, but thank you, because otherwise this wouldn't happen. Now that we've got our smoker sorted out, we've got our beehive sorted out, we'll show you how to put the bees in the beehive.